today I'm on the couch with David Laws, who I've known for about 2 or 3 weeks now. But David is actually a very talented psychic medium, and the way he uses his craft is through flower reading. So, David, how about you tell us a bit about yourself?
Thanks, Cam. Thank you for that wonderful introduction. Cameron, it's an interesting process, the flower reading. I guess from a very young age I was aware that I had a gift of psychic ability from a very young age of around about 9 or 10. But as far as flower readings are concerned, I didn't actually start reading flowers until I was probably in my mid to late 20s, I guess. So it's 2 or 3 weeks I've been reading them now. So it's around about 23, 24 years that I've actually been reading flowers. It's an interesting process, Cam, because when people select a flower, there's a particular protocol to follow, which is very simple. And people select an item from the garden. The reason I've chosen flowers, Cam, to read more than anything else in psychometry is something that you can utilise on articles, jewellery, and what have you. But when you select an item from the garden, be it a flower, a twig, a leaf,
organic,
something that nature has produced and grown, when people select that, they've imbued it with their energy the moment they touch it. Just blow on it, drop it into a paper bag, making sure that nobody else touches it, and one person out of the group brings all the bags in and lays them on the floor in front of me. And from that process, I then open up the bag, take out the flower, and I channel with my eyes closed. That way I utilise my inner senses to their greatest ability, and I deliver the message.
When you say you channel, different psychic mediums that I've met have different ways that they do this. Do you actually channel through spirit, or how does it work for you?
Good question, Cam. Basically, the way that it works for me is that I refer to myself as a spiritual switchboard operator. So, for want of a better term, because I am merely a conduit. I'm just a channel, and the messages come through me. They do not come from me. So I make it clear to people, Cam, that I'm just the deliverer of what comes to me, either in sight, through sound, through taste, through smell. I utilise as many of the senses as I can from an internal point of view, and this is what hones my gift and enables me to bring as sharp a message to the recipient as possible.
Right. And look, I've got a bit of an advantage here. We've been talking and drinking coffee all night, so it's...
Cap into the eyeball.
It's 11 o'clock-ish now, but we couldn't help ourselves. 10 to 12. But look, also, one thing that, and you can share a story in a minute, that some people, do you need to... pick the organic flower or plant from your own garden?
Good question again, Cam. Not necessarily so from my own experience. Some people say that it has to be from your garden. Well, that may or may not be the case. For me personally, I've been able to conduct some fantastic readings from people who have selected a particular item from their next door neighbour's garden or from a garden across the road or down in the park. Doesn't necessarily have to be from your own property, but if you do select it from a property outside of your own, there's a possibility that you may pick up some messages pertaining to that property or the people that own it.
Can you give us, and again, you told me a really good story earlier, so give us a story in relation to the one that you had a couple of weeks ago.
Mm-hmm. Sure. Utilising the taste, the sense of taste and smell, and of course vision. I had a couple of ladies that arrived at the front door of a particular place where I was doing some readings. Everybody had fairly much settled down and was sitting down. We still had the basket sitting at the front door where people were leaving their flowers as they arrived. The last two ladies arrived, and one of the ladies put her flower down in the basket and walked in to take her seat around where I was sitting in the lounge room, which was quite a way away. But I said to the lady, "I can smell your flower already, and it's still in the paper bag." And she said, "What do you mean?" And I could smell, and I said, "Are you a chef?" And she said, "No." I said, "There's beautiful food around your flower. It's in the bag over there." I said, "It's wafting over, and I can see in front of me here like food that's been created by a chef. It looks like it's restaurant quality food." And I asked her if her girlfriend was a chef, and she said no. And then all of a sudden she went, "Oh my God." And I said, "What?" And she said, "Look, it's just hit me." She said, "I was in such a rush to get here tonight. I was running late from work, and I rang my girlfriend, Kim, and said, 'Hey, let's meet down the street, have a quick bite to eat. We haven't got time to get dinner ready.' and we'll go around to David's flower reading. And she said, we're sitting there in the cafe / restaurant, and I suddenly realised I'd forgotten to pick a flower at home to bring down. So she was looking around, and there in the middle of the restaurant was a little garden. And she went over to the chef of the restaurant, or the cafe where she was, and said, look, this is the strangest question, but can I please pick a flower out of your garden? He said, help yourself. He gave her a plastic bag. Her girlfriend had already chosen a flower, so the lady picked it up and blew on it, put it in the bag, put it down, and hence the story of the smell of the food.
So the essence of the venue carried the flower, which correct. Is really fascinating.
Very
and I'm sure you've got plenty of other stories that we won't talk about tonight.
Lots of stories. 23 years worth.
Right. So if let's pretend I'm going to have a flower reading in my place, what is the protocol or what happens on the night?
Okay. Very simple and easy to follow, but there is a protocol to follow to get the best result. Basically, Cam, the way that I put it is that when people bring a flower, they should select an item and just blow on it to imbue it with your own energy. Do not let anyone else touch it because it will taint your own energy and therefore you may get a cross message. Drop it into the bag, tighten it up, make sure nobody else touches it, and bring it along. Very simple and easy and straightforward.
And from that point, you select a flower and you do a reading from that flower. And what happens after that? And do you actually match the flower to the person after that?
Correct. Absolutely. I don't identify any of the flowers until all of the readings are complete.
Yeah.
So once I've done that, once I've finished the reading of one particular item, I'll lay the flower down on its bag, spread them all out. And this is where it's really good at the end because I get to identify each of the flowers with their particular owner and therefore relate all the messages. And that is the most fascinating part of the night. And for me, it's a bit like sitting under the Christmas tree because I really get to start finding out, you know, what the correlation was and how, you know, clear the messages were that came through. And at the end of that, when that's finished, I will then ask who owns what flower. And once I've identified the owner, I may then go into the
over, and to the layperson who may not understand over, it's a one-on-one where you channel.
Thank you very much. That's exactly right.
And it's almost like a personal reading.
It is indeed, because once we've identified the flower with the owner of the flower may or may not have any questions, and because of the fact that I'm sitting there still within channeling mode and still working with spirit, there may be an opportunity for me to deliver a further message simply by sitting on the floor and looking at the person and tuning into their energy, and it's amazing what comes out in our overhead reading sometimes.
So you could say you get an essence of the person's energy.
Yes.
What about dealing with people that are passed? Do you sometimes get that as well?
From time to time you will have a deceased one's energy come through and deliver a message to a loved one. And again, the switchboard operator will attempt to bring the message from the person who has passed over to the person in the room. There's been so many amazing experiences of that over the years.
I'm thinking of it. And I think another good thing, what numbers do you need for the night?
Okay. With the flower reading channelings or parties, whatever your gatherings, or I suppose you could refer to, I prefer a minimum of 6 people and a maximum of 8. Simply because, Cam, it's a good number to work with for one evening, because everybody gets a good reading and everyone gets some good messages without it being too draining on me, and it gives them good quality.
And that's what I like, because, you know, you come to some parties like this, let's call it a party, you've got 10 or 20 people, they can't get the quality of feedback that you can with 6 to 8.
That's right.
So it's not all about the dollars, it's about getting a quality reading on the night.
It's not all about that. And the thing is, too, because this is my path. This is my chosen path in life. And each and every one of us is here for a purpose. This is my purpose. And nothing thrills me more than when I can go out and meet fabulous new people that have got a million questions and they're really opening up to the world of spirituality. And it's my gift and talent, I guess, that has been able to bring this gift to the layperson to help them understand that there's no voodoo, spooky stuff about this work. It is beautiful work.
And I've got a good question. There's people out there thinking, well, I would want a party, but is it serious stuff?
Yes.
Am I not allowed to have a drink? You know, is it a street straight party? Or can we have a couple of wines? Does that impact on what happens?
Oh, look, bit of spiritual support via the glass doesn't go astray. Yeah. So. And it's a great way for people to relax, to open up, and to make it a lot of fun. I've been doing this for many, many years now, as you heard, and it's a wonderful way to bring a group of friends together to touch in the world of spirituality. There's a touch of entertainment, but the two essences that make this work canon more than anything, the two essences I look for and I cannot work without, is love and laughter. Tons of laughter and tons of love. If I don't have love or laughter, it makes it very hard for me to work. So there's a lot of humour involved. It's very uplifting, a lot of fun, tons and tons of love. So you'll get a hug or two. And it's just a great, great experience. And I'm lucky enough to have quite a large following here on the Gold Coast. And it's really good.
So the main thing to remember from here, David can come to your home. Good thing about six is it's not a large number to have to try to achieve. So below here we'll have a couple of things. We'll have David's website, we'll have David's contact details, phone number, give him a call, and also his email address. So if you've got a question, just send him an email if you don't want to give him a call after the thing. So this is a quick insight into David. I've only known him a short time, but he's very entertaining, he's very warming, and he's very good at what he does. So give David a call.
Got the check in the mail, mate. Thanks very much.
Thanks, Dave.
Thanks a lot, Cam, and thank you very much. And I look forward to meeting you over a flower or two one day. God bless.
Bye-bye.